Welcome to Spirit Life Media, the audio-visual scripture and music ministry of Tree by the River Church. Acts 20 verse 32 says, I commend you to the word of His grace, which is able to build you up and give you an inheritance amongst the saints. God's best for you is stored up in His word to you. Therefore, this medium is God's channel to get His best across to you. Be blessed.
Something so much that it's so overwhelming and it's beautiful at the same time. It's just lovely. I can live like that. It's how I want to live. It's how I want to live. What about you? What is drawing you the most? What if you had 10 days? Your whole life was 10 days. How would you want to live those 10 days? Just 10 days. Day 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. And they just brought you into the 10 days. Start life now. What? How would you want to live? I want to live by pleasing God. My desire to please God makes it easy for me to go before my wife and say, I'm sorry. And kneel down and say, I'm sorry. My desire, I have no qualms to say I'm sorry, forgive me. I have no qualms to say I'm sorry to any of you if I offend you. I have no qualms to do anything that God wants me to do. There is no thus saith the Lord that I cannot pursue by the grace of God. And there is none that I do not desire to pursue. Maybe I don't know about it. Or maybe I'm pursuing it and I stumble. Because you see, the Bible says, the steps of a good man, they are ordered of God. And because God delights in him, even though he stumbles, he'll pick him up again. Which race are you in? Which race are you in? Well, you know, I wrote an article once, what's driving you? And that day I was just looking at people. Have you been to Oshodi? You see this mass sea of humanity. When Oshodi was Oshodi, just human beings. And I just looked. What's driving them? What's driving? Why this man there that's running into that bus? What is his all-consuming passion? The other one who is selling, the other one who is driving the bus, the other one who's driving the Mercedes. What is their all-consuming passion? What is moving each one? What is it driving? Each person is driven for something. Yesterday, my wife was telling me a story. She went to minister somewhere in the afternoon. Someone's birthday or something. And while she was there, somebody came and shared a testimony. I was warning people to be careful the way I understand it. To be careful. She works in this big company or whatever. And she said, do you know this minister, this one? You know what they're doing? Now one day they came to meet her and said, follow us to Abuja. Let's do something for you. And the lady was telling them, she ran as far as the east is from the west, because if you go to Abuja, you will never come back the same. They enlist you, they initiate you into their societies. But they give you freebies. You'll see them with the latest Land Rover 470. You'll see them with the beggar's house now, 5-4 stories in Banana Island. And, you know, what's driving them? What's driving you? What's driving you? What's driving you defines your life. That's your life right there. What's driving you defines your life. There's no man who is driven by the desire to please God that will be comfortable in a place where there is evil going on. You cannot. You will not. You know, one day I said to somebody, or to some people, I said to them, they said, if somebody brought 500 million naira or $5 million into this church as a gift, and you knew that it was a stolen money and a fraudulent, say, will you take it? Won't you shut your eyes? I just laughed at them. I have no interest in that. It's not a factor of his 500 million. If it's not something that makes God happy, I have no interest in it. It is that God makes it happy that I have interest in it. That it doesn't please God, it doesn't please me. It's not the money. The money is nothing. It's not the volume, it's the value. It has value to me because it has value to God. What is driving you? I want you to check your heart this morning. You know, there's some people right now, it's just how to go to work, come back. How to go to work, come back. What is your life about? If you had 10 days, is this what it's about? How to go to work and come back. Some people, you don't even know what is life about. Just go to work, come back. Go to work, come back. Eat, sleep, come back. This today, I added, watch a channel of love. Then eat, sleep, then I watch This Awakening Generation. Eat, sleep, come back. Go to work, come back. What is this? Hallelujah. You know, I started talking to you last week about, I told you that God never leaves any generation without a witness. And Jesus Christ is the true and faithful witness. I read that to you in Revelation chapter 3. Jesus Christ, from verse 14, he says, the true and faithful witness. He witnessed, see, God in every generation. Listen to this. I read that again in Acts 14. It says, he never leaves any generation without a witness. Even if that witness is stones, he will use stones to witness that he is God. No generation. Listen, one of the major essence of our being on this earth is to witness of God, the reality of God. And because we have laid hold of him, we must pursue so deep until our lives become a beacon of God. Can you imagine that on the face of this earth? You know, people today, they talk about maybe a rich man. Have you ever seen people talk about, you know, maybe Bill Gates or one of these people, and they're telling you how they are example of how you don't have to go to school and you can be the richest person on earth. Their lives have become a beacon. A beacon that you can succeed in the terms of what man calls successful on this earth. It's good. They can pursue that. But there are some people, their lives can be a beacon that God is alive. Because they exist, God has a witness. Because they exist, God has a witness. And this doesn't come ordinarily. That is why some of you may have read certain scriptures, but you don't know what you are reading. I want to help you out in an area. When you read Hebrews and chapter 11, He's talking of beacons. He's talking of witnesses, people who came, they witnessed of the reality of God. That's all Hebrews 11. Hebrews 11 is not for emptiness and all these things that people are looking for all over the place and materialism. No. Hebrews 11 is about witness. So, Pastor, how do you know? Because Hebrews 12 tells us very conveniently. You know, let's go to Hebrews chapter 12 from verse 1. Wherefore, anywhere I have taught you before, anywhere you see wherefore or therefore, what does that mean? It's a conjunction. It means that it is joining something that was said before. It is emphasizing it. It is qualifying it. It's telling you that if you didn't understand it, understand this. It's telling you that everything I have said before is so that I can say this. You see? So if I say, this man is an African, this man lives in Nigeria, this man is from Imo State, therefore, you need to understand that he speaks Igbo very fluently and he eats akpu very seriously. That therefore is there to qualify this man is from Imo State and an African man. They are connected. So you can never read Hebrews chapter 11 without reading Hebrews chapter 12. You will get an incomplete statement. A whole generation has read Hebrews chapter 11 and they've run out with a wrong definition because the landing of Hebrews chapter 11 is Hebrews chapter 12. Wherefore? Wherefore, all that I've said, you know, Hebrews 11 talks about the heroes of faith. It's telling you the objective, what they were trying to do, what they were trying to achieve. And though it has been turned to self-seeking and materialism, chapter 12 tells us it's a lie. Because chapter 12 tells us, because of all this we are saying, it says, seeing also we are compassed with a great cloud of witnesses. You see, all these people, they are a great cloud of witnesses. They are all witnesses in this adventure into God. They are witnesses that God is real. They are witnesses that God is alive. There are witnesses that a man can go into all the world and be a witness of God, of Jesus Christ. So wherefore, seeing that you are encompassed with so great a cloud, you are encompassed with a cloud of witnesses. Their lives are there to show you what the adventure of God is about. Amen. Their lives are there to show us what it means because they are witnesses. They were witnesses. They lived through this life and they were witnesses of God. They are a cloud of witnesses. We are encompassed by so great a cloud. Let us lay aside every weight. You see where they are arriving. It's not talking about the materialism that people pursue when they talk about faith. And there is nothing wrong to use your faith secondarily to sort out basic things. But you know that sometimes your faith can get you to the place where you will die. Yes, the Bible teaches us. This church in Smyrna, it says, wherefore some of you are about to be killed. But don't lose your faith. How can you have, in today's type of faith, if they kill you, then you don't have faith. But in the Bible faith, you can have faith and they end up cutting you up your neck. Something's wrong about what we are believing. He says, so make sure you do not deny the Lord that you will be tempted 10 days and some of you will be killed. But hold on to your faith. Some of them were, they said, who through faith? Some received their dead back to life. This is good. That's what faith can do. Some wrought righteousness. We'll get that towards the end. But he says some were sown asunder through faith. They were cut in half through faith. So we must understand this. These people are there. They showed us something and then he's summarizing it. He used their life to show something. And he says don't miss the point of what I was trying to use their life to show. Because we are surrounded with this great crowd of witnesses, let us lay aside every weight. And the sin that does so easily beset us and run this race This adventure of being witnesses of God. This adventure of manifesting the image of God in this life. What Adam could not do. This adventure of knowing what it is to pursue, to seek God with all your heart. It's an adventure. And let us run, it's a race. This is what's driving us. What's driving us is that we are witnesses. We are witnesses that are driven by such a passion to see him, to get him, to own him, that he will be our portion in this life, to prove him. He says, proving what is the will of God. To prove him. To manifest him. To partake of his nature in such a way that people say, yes, it is true. And so as I stand here, I cannot rest again until I am manifesting. The dead is being raised through my life because God said this is who I must be. I cannot rest again until love of God is so freely manifested in me. Until humility of Christ and the meekness of Christ is so freely manifested in me. This becomes a new driving passion. This is the driving passion of those who call themselves children of God. And that is what he said to Abraham. We will visit a few of them. He went back and said to them, he said to Abraham, 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 he said, walk before me, I'll be your reward. I will be your reward. He didn't talk about rewarder at that time. The call of Abraham, there's nothing about rewarder. He's talking about, yes, I will make your name great and all of that. But I, be the pursuit, the reward you are looking for. I want to be the reward. Walk with me. Sadly, I know that the devil is in the mix of it all. But the hearts of people who claim to be in church has a calibration issue. I've been talking about calibration for a while now. Because something that is being passed across to us is not helping us to have this drive and this pursuit. The hearts of many people have become cold. And that is such a symptom of the end times. Because in Matthew 24:10, it says, and the hearts of men will wax cold. This is what will happen in the end times. It will wax cold. People will not be in this race. They will deceive themselves. Because 2 Timothy chapter 3 from verse 1 tells us that. They will deceive themselves. They will be lovers of pleasures more than lovers of God. Did you see that he calls that a sin? He says, and then he calls that a deceit, because he said that they'll be lovers of pleasures more than lovers of God. They'll be boastful, they'll be proud. That means they're not changing to the image of God. They have weights and all kinds of sins, and they are not caring about that. They are deceiving themselves with all kinds of false things all around the whole place. And he says, flee from this type of people. They are not in that race. They will have a form of godliness. They will come to church, they will sing, they will dance. But they're not in this race. You guys are not in the same game. You know, if you are an athlete, the other day we're visiting with my sister in the U.S. and she has these sons that are superstars. They're athletes, very good athletes. They've gotten scholarship to some of the best, most expensive universities in the U.S. because they play basketball and they play American football. So they are, you know, really looking for them everywhere. They have all kinds of benefits as a result of this. You want to eat this, they don't eat any kind of thing. Their bodies, if you see them, they are like Incredible Hulk. When they fly, one of them, if you see the picture he has on the internet, when he flies to catch a ball, his leg is on your head. That is, he's jumping up. When they caught him in the air, his leg is at the height of somebody's head. That's the type of thing they eat, their condition. You don't come and meet them and come, hey, take guguru and ekpa. When you give them guguru and ekpa, when they jump, their head will be on your knees. Their leg will be on your knees. You can't reach head again. Because there's a conditioning. So if they stay around people eating guguru and ekpa, they have to leave those type of people. Because guguru and ekpa people is going to make them not jump high again. This is what God is saying. He says, these are the cloud. These are the type of people you should be around. You need to observe this type of people and see how they are able to touch God. How they were able to be witnesses. They are a cloud of witnesses. Because you must be a witness of God on this earth. Like I said, your heart has to be conditioned. You are living in a generation that's not going to condition your heart. It is a narrow road. Those of us whose hearts will be conditioned this way will enjoy such a great grace from God to even access this road. The average person today is going to be like 2 Timothy chapter 3 from verse 1 to verse 8. They are going to be lovers of pleasures, lovers of boasting, lovers of all kinds of things. They are not going to love God. But they will say they do. They will be in church because the scripture says they are ever learning but never coming to the truth. Because something about the truth must change you into the image of Christ. Something about the truth must make you a witness, a true witness, someone that will prove God in your lifetime. So they are ever learning. They listen to church, they come to all these things, but they are ever learning but never able. They don't have the ability. They don't have the grace. You know what grace is? Divine ability. That means they don't have the grace to come to the knowledge of truth because that's not what they are seeking. Grace comes by seeking it. Come boldly. Their drive, their desire, their passion. And you can never fool God. So it goes on in Hebrews and chapter 12. It says, so we should lay aside the weight and the sin that does so easily beset us and run with patience the race. There's a race set before you, my dear brothers and sisters. It's a race to be a part of this cloud. You know when we sing, oh, when the saints go marching in. I wish someone can change it for me. Oh, when the witnesses, I don't know whether it will rhyme, but when the witnesses go marching in. Oh, when the witnesses go marching in. Oh, Lord, I want to be in the number. Oh, when the witnesses go marching in. See, there's an arcade now. There's an army of witnesses that are, they are being translated from time to time, from generation to generation. When they come in, you will cross over one day. Don't cross over without being a real witness. Heaven is watching you. Heaven is waiting for you. Heaven wants to see. Heaven is forever. Eternity is forever. All this one we are doing here is nothing. Let us do the one, when we enter, you know, the other day I was invited to speak in a graduation of a secondary school. And when I got there, one or two people were just speaking the prizes. Best in literature. You need to see the, so just young girls, young boys, one or just a few of them. Best in this, best in this, best in this, just a few of them. I fear that that's what's going to happen when we are getting to heaven. Just a few people. And at that time, you realize there's no reverse, there's no rewind, there's no going back. At that time, you realize, just like some of them who must have sat down, the other students, with this one, if I read a little more, look at now, I have all the time in the world. I have all the time in the world to play. If I had read a little more, I might have been one of these people that's been honored today. I might have been one of these people that's been celebrated today. And one of them, when the governor of Lagos State was there, greeting all of them, giving all some of them all kinds of special gifts. And then they would think to themselves, I could have done this. Don't cross over into eternity regretting. You had the opportunity to honor God and to be a witness of God. So he says you must lay to be a part of that witness. He says, wherefore, you can see these people that were there. This is what they were pursuing. They were pursuing God. And the pursuit of God involves that you must lay aside weight. You must lay aside sin. I was telling a group of people yesterday, I said, look, gone are those days where pastor will be begging you, hey, don't be angry with your wife. Don't be sinning. You are sinning. You don't fear God. You don't honor God. A person who can boldly go and slap his wife has no fear of God. Forget your grammar that you are talking about. A person who can go to his office and be stealing money have no fear of God. You are not somebody who wants to be a part of the witnesses. That's what he's trying to say. Lay aside the weight and the sin and let us run. There's a race. It's a race that Paul talked about. I have fought the good fight. I have run the race. I have finished my course. Oh, there's a race. There's a race. We're running it. And it's a race to honor God. That's what happened with all these men. Look at Jesus Christ in verse 2. The Bible says, now, This cloud of witnesses is there. But now we are going to look unto Jesus Christ. How did he run his own race? He's the forerunner who has gone ahead of us. How did he run his own race? We are going to run as he ran. He is the author and the finisher of our faith. And of course, we already know what Galatians chapter 2 and verse 20 says. I am crucified with Christ. Nevertheless, I live. Yet not I. That means that's the race. Can I prove to you that's the race? He says, yet not I. He says, the life I now live in the flesh, I live by the faith of the Son of God. He says now he's the author and finisher of our faith. So we have to live as Jesus lived, by the faith of the Son of God. How did he live? He lived his whole life to honor God. Lo, I come in the volume of this book to do thy will, O God. His whole motivation, his drive in life, his, when everybody's running where they're running, this one running to make money. The person who's running to make money, is easy for him to cheat, to kill, to steal. It's easy for him to go to Abuja and go and become a homosexual. I was praying with somebody this last week. I said, Pastor, pray for me. They want to change me to homosexual so that they can give me money. They promise me they will give me this. They will give me that. Just that I can do this. Just like this lady was talking about. Come to Abuja. We'll give you houses. We'll give you cars. When can you tell that one to Abraham? Imagine telling Moses, this is Pharaoh. I'm sorry, don't go from Egypt. Don't go from Egypt. Come back. You had 20 houses on Asokoro and in Mayfair and in Parkview and Banana Island. Now I trebled houses. I'm giving you 50 houses each. You didn't have in Lekki phase one. I give you phase one on top. Moses, I looked at your account. There's only $50 million there in the account in Germany. And then there's 250 in the one in America. And the Egypt account, all you have is $1 billion. Moses, I make it 20 billion. Come back. What do you think Moses will say? In your mind, think about it. You say, you don't understand. I'm looking at something. You're talking of, you know. But if you met him a few years before, he will even help you bring blood for you. How many souls do you want? Pharaoh, so that I can have this 5 billion. What is driving him? What's driving you? What's driving you determines where you're going, what you're going to do with your life. A person who is not broken at what God said doesn't know what it is to walk with God. In fact, he doesn't even have a heart for God. A person who can do as you like, oblivious and careless. I was telling marriage people when I had a marriage meeting yesterday. God is both trainer and referee in your marriage. As a trainer, he teaches you what to do. He tells you what it means to love your wife. You proactively, because you are in this race to please God, you proactively go and seek him. What does this mean? And then you learn it. And then he helps you, chastening you, building you. And as a referee, when there's a problem, he says no. Lord, you don't know what she's doing. I'll split her. I'll teach her a big lesson. No, go and apologize to her. Boom. Where's the whistle? Have you seen those referees? I watch one wrestling. He just pushed the referee and punched the person. They just disqualified him on the spot. Many of us are being disqualified. Because you just... you don't care that God is there. He's telling you. He says, Saul, Saul, why are you kicking against the pricks? You know that the direction you are going is enmity against God. It's insulting to God. You know the direction you are going. God is not pleased with it, but you go all the same. And then you say you are serving God. You are deceiving yourself. That's not what these men were doing. That's not what Jesus came. Looking unto him. Then go on to verse 3. It tells us in verse 3 that, so you can see how he's trying to qualify this cloud of witnesses. He says that these guys, looking unto Jesus, who for the cross that was set before him endured the throne, for consider him who endured such contradictions of sinners. How did he endure contradiction of sinners? Because they treated him so badly. The Bible says his visage was so mad. That means his body was so broken We have not understood the suffering that Jesus went through. Isaiah captures it better. He knew all of this. And he wanted to run away at some point. He wanted to say, Father, take this cup away from me. God said no. So his desire to please God was more than the pain. His desire to please God was more than the shame. They stripped Jesus naked. Are you aware of that? Put terrible things on his head. Peppery things on his head. They flogged him. They said with each whip, his body scattered. That Passion of Christ movie, best capture of all the movies that have been brought of Jesus Christ. We are trying to make it soft. But that is the movie that captures closest what Jesus must have gone through. He suffered it. So he's saying that Jesus, the ultimate witness, the true and faithful witness, see what he went through. Contradiction. What is the contradiction you're facing in your home? Tell me. Are you facing a contradiction? I have this tough wife. I have this tough husband. Honor God. Love her all the same. Are you facing a contradiction in your office? I have this situation. Everybody's been promoted. That's because they're all yielding to this evil. They're all doing the bribe that the manager says I should do. But, you know, I'm not doing it, so they're not moving me up. Endure it. It's nothing. It says, you know what Jesus endured? To please God. Do you know what? You have to look unto him. If you say you are a Christian, you have to follow his way. You have to walk in his way, not in the way of another person, not in the way of somebody else. His way. This is his way. This is Christianity right here. He says, look, because he endured all of this. Why? Because he wanted to please God, lest you be weary and faint. Yeah, some people have wearied and fainted to the point they have divorced their spouses. Some people have wearied to the point that they have gone to do things. A brother once came to meet me. Pastor, I'm going to Bar Beach. In Bar Beach, they will take your blood. And then they will go into the beach and they will take it into water and they will tell you all the root of all your problems and what you must do to move forward. He called it, I forgot what he called it, read your blood or something like that. Because weary. He has not had job for a long time. To him, that is weariness. Pastor, you don't know. And I listened to him say, he was a young man at the time. He has been unemployed for about 5 years. And to him, oh, you don't know what I'm suffering. A lady wrote to me last week, and she said, Pastor, I've been married. So at the end, she wrote when she was married. She said, I cry every day that we've been waiting for God for a child. Why is God treating us this way? Why is God treating us? Now, you know, since we married in 2014. You married in 2014, and this is still 2015, just by 2 extra months. I can't call this 2016, because just 1.5 extra months. If I say 2015, you add something more than it is. So that is talking about less than 2 years. Now you are weary. Why is God? He said, if you see the writing, I wish I can read it. Say, I've been bitterness in my soul. Against who? Against God. So I wrote her back. I said, my dear sister, you are not yet born again. You need to be born again. I said, you are serving God with your lips, but your heart's far from him. I said, your life belongs to you. It doesn't belong to God. When it belongs to God, you will release it for him. Have you gone through what Job went through? Have you gone through what Jesus went through? You know what Jesus went through? Do you want to be naked in the street? How would you feel today if you knew that I'm going out today? Just imagine you woke up in the morning and you have a clear-cut angel. Say, today as you go out, when you get to Obanikoro, somebody is going to come and accuse you falsely and strip you naked and flog you. If you go out today, will you go out? What are you going to do? You stay at home. What if they said to you that God wants you to go? God, the angel said, God told me. You still don't agree? That's what happened to Jesus. Jesus said, no, not my will. He knows they are going to strip him naked. He knows they are going to beat him up. He knows that what he's going to experience is beyond. He doesn't want it, but God wants it. So he walks into it. All right, let them do it. Then you, who's married, you say, I don't have child. God, why now? What are you talking about? Walk with God. Walk with God. Do you know what Abraham did? Walking with God, seeking God. You see, what are you looking for? When I listen to the young lady, she's, her heart is not towards God. Self. When your heart is towards God, you'll be content with what he gives you. You will seek him for more if there's need, but you will come because you will yield to him. My life is not my own. We sing it, we don't mean it. To you I belong. It's such a sweet, nice song. I give myself to you. Then they will add your, oh, life is not my own. I give it. I'll just shut up. You are lying. Life is your own. That's why you're upset. God said, okay, leave me. For the next 5 years, I don't want a child in this marriage yet. I need to use you for other things. No. God, that's not the agreement. There's no other agreement. It's my life. You, so relax. Ah, God, I don't agree. I have bitterness also. How can you have bitterness also? What things that's not yours? Is that not a covetous message? A person who is having bitterness of soul to the owner of the property. You can have the whole world. Do not go with me. Still I will follow. Even if I don't get anything, I follow him. I'm a witness. You see, this is how this meant. And that's what Hebrews 11 is teaching us. Hebrews 11 talks about somebody like Moses. Listen to the fake thing that's going on. What it really means to seek God. Hebrews 11, you'll see 11 from verse 24. I'm just going to pick two or three of them and just show you who this cloud of witnesses are. What they are pursuing. Whether it's the same thing driving us. Whether we are in the race that they were in or we are in the race of worldly race today. By faith, Moses, when he had come to years, when he matured, he refused to be called the son of Pharaoh. No more. I want to identify in this direction. Somebody needs to come to years today. You need to come of age today. You need to get to the place where you know who you are in Christ and say no more. I'm not going on this rat race, world race. That's not my race. This is not for me. I don't care how beautiful you have all the pleasures. I'm in a race. I'm a crop of people who are coming on this earth for something. Oh God. I sit down to myself and I say to myself, I am John chapter 1 verse 6. And there was a man sent from God, and his name is Mazino. I'm not of this crop. I don't belong to this world. You need to meditate on this very seriously until you know who you are. We don't know. We've lost identity in the church. He chose to suffer with the reproaches. He esteemed it. Choosing rather to suffer affliction with the people of God than to enjoy the pleasure of seeing for a season. Esteeming the reproach of Christ greater riches than the treasures of Egypt. Have you gotten there? Honestly, I remember telling one particular guy, and he said to me, you are lying. If you see $50 million cash, you will do it. If you whether they stole it, you will fold your eyes. I say, you don't know what you're talking about. After a while, I don't want to argue with you. We're in different races. I don't need it. You see, it has no value. It's not valuable because it's $50 million. It's valuable because I can enjoy what God gave me. God didn't give me a stolen money. It's devil gives you stolen money. Imagine going around the whole place and I have $50 million, but you stole, you killed, you cheated for that money. I will not even enjoy it. When I'm spending, my spirit is gone. What makes me enjoy anything is that God, when a man's ways please the Lord, is that it was gotten in the pathway of righteousness. Anything outside there doesn't hold any value. He hates those things that God hates, and he loves the things that God loves. This is Moses. He esteemed it. You cannot come and meet Moses at that time and tell Moses, Moses, go, Pharaoh has increased your salary. He'll be laughing. I'm not laughing at this guy. You think money is valuable because it's volume? No. The Bible says, better is a woman who has a little in her house than a house full of treasures with strife. The little I have. We were driving to the church this morning, very early, and we're just exhorting in the car. And I said to my children and to my wife, I said, you know, we have such peace and joy in our home. I said, you know, sometimes I feel guilty that God has blessed me too much. And I said, we may never be rich. We may never be people who have... I said, the kingdom is living. We are enjoying righteousness, peace, and joy in the Holy Ghost. It's so deep that I said, we may not have much, but we are content. We are so rich in contentment. Listen, walk with God. This thing they are looking for, God will give you. Eyes have not seen. Ears have not heard. See, have you heard of people who pass down an old brass ring? Brass wedding ring. It was given by my great-grandmother to my grandmother. Therefore, my grandmother, she gave it to my mother. Then my mother has given it to me. Now I want to give it to my daughter. She's ready to pay $50,000 for that ring rather than a pure gold ring. It's who gave it to you that matters. God gave me. I didn't do anything. I just walk with God. I'm okay with that. That's the one I need. Stop fooling yourselves. So this is who these witnesses were. There were people who were running away from sin. They hated the treasures of Egypt. Nothing about Egypt appealed to them anymore. Do you understand this? It's a calibration of the heart. Nothing about it doesn't appeal. I personally, when I see a lady who overly, and I'm not insulting anybody, when you are overly colorful, like a peacock, eyes are green here, this one are yellow, this is black, and then ears, the earring is written like a Jezebel, you actually do look ugly to me, honestly. When I see somebody who is closer to nature, I have nothing against a lipstick or anything, but what I'm trying to say is that there's something more beautiful about meekness. There's something more beautiful about simplicity. There's something more beautiful about ordinariness. When you see a minister who comes, imagine if you come to this church now. Please come, two of you. Come, please, I beg of you. Just imagine now, Pastor Mazino is coming. No, you have to look stern. Anybody who is coming near me, don't allow them. Don't allow them to stop. Hallelujah. You can't fold your hand like a man or something. Oh yeah, come and attack me. Come and do like you want to attack me. Yeah, correct, bodyguard. So you see, as the Lord is speaking to you, the Lord says, I should say to you, now listen, I'm 28 years old. I just finished secondary school, university. Who is pursuing you? This is the craziness happening in the church. World has taken over our head. We're having pastors. They're moving around the place where we should be meekest of the people with siren. They push you off the road. Pastor, Christian, what is this? Who are you? What's driving you? When meekness is driving you, you cannot go that way. Learn of me. I am meek. I'm lonely in heart. What's driving you? It's something that's driving such a person. It's not Christ. It's not a pleasing God. You bring body. What I went for a program in one of the tertiary universities. Young children started running. Like 20 of them. How many of them? So many were following our car. University. Under what now? I was so grieved. I took the microphone. I said, you guys, stop this type of evil things. You're being spoiled by your fathers. The umbilical cord that is connecting to you is corrupting you. What is this? Who am I? Why are we emulating superstars? We're to emulate Christ. We bring all these corrupt people, they call them superstars, into the church. They come, Jesus, Ejemba, Jesus, Ejemba. Come on. Nothing that takes me to Jesus Christ. The only addition there is Jesus, Jemba. We don't even know Jemba is an occultic word that they ask them to add inside the word. Jesus, Jemba, then they now start. Banye. Then they now, in the film, you watch their television of their program, you will see Homer. Then you start coming down from Homer. Why? Why didn't you come from Manger? That's what is driving them. Then we give them our pulpits. You know why? Because they appeal to the flesh. And they know that people are going to come from far and wide. I don't want such type of souls. Because how they come is how you're going to sustain them. Let's be small forever, if that's what God wants. If Holy Spirit cannot come down suddenly while we are speaking and cause a harvest of souls, then we will wait till he comes. The church is not ready to wait on the Lord at all. We're not seeking God. We're looking for shortcuts. Then we get this young, some of them are so young. I was driving on my street. I saw young boys. You see them on the billboards. They are novices. The Bible said, don't give them novices a space. Somebody just came here. I was a witchcraft tomorrow, and today I became a born again, become evangelist, witchcraft, former witchcraft evangelist. What evangelist are you? What do you know about the word of God? Share your testimony and go and learn the Bible. Go and learn scriptures. A small boy has no doctrine. He's already writing some, and then we are promoting him all over the place. He's passing death to our young generation. Our young generation will become, they want to be like him. That's why we are losing our children. We have not discerned what it is to seek God. We don't want to wait on him. Everything is in a hurry. Everything is on the fast lane. We don't want to pass the narrow way. Anything the world does, the world is now doing reality TV. Church must do it too. World is the light of the world. Yes. No. I said what I said. The world has become the light of the world. What is light? Is for you to follow. We ought to have taught them what meekness is, so they can follow us. We ought to have taught them what humility is, so they can follow us. We ought to have taught them what contentment is, so they can follow us. We ought to have taught them what holiness is, so they can follow us. Admire it and say, whoa, see their homes. They are very simple, but there's such love. There's such peace. No. Now we want to be like them. They are leading us. They start one thing, we want to follow it. The only difference is that sometimes we add Jesus to our own. That's not how these people were living. They esteem the reproaches of Christ. I esteem contentment. I esteem gentleness. I esteem meekness. I esteem obedience and holiness. I esteem humility. But those things are nonsense to this generation of Christians. That's why we're running after them. What will make... You see, people say, oh, you're controversial. You're saying this. Jesus was controversial. If Jesus preached the messages of most of our generation of ministers are preaching today, he would not have crucified him. Yes. Years ago, Leonard Ravenhill, he made that statement. If Jesus preached the messages that today they have been preaching and they are celebrating them and fill of crowds, they won't crucify him. Caiaphas, who was the high priest, he would be his body. Hey, JC, Jesus said, hey, in the house. JC, in the house. Message of God is not palatable with flesh. What is making servants of God? I keep thinking to myself, as a younger minister, I even used to think, when I start growing up, am I going to be somebody who's going to be, you know, moving around like this? And I've still yet to see myself do that. And I will not do that by the grace. It doesn't even appeal to me. It doesn't even when I meet my brother. You see, there's a mutual respect existing between all of us. But that respect, all nine name honor, I give honor to who due. It didn't say give worship. It didn't say turn them into an idol or something of the nature. Now you must call me daddy. You know, pastors are proactively pushing it. Call me daddy, papa, Gio, my Gio. My papa. And he's the pastor. A brother came to my office the other day. Young boy. Telling me how that his church, the pastor taught him sonship. He said, and I wish he said something else. He said, I learned sonship. He said, from that day, I started calling my pastor papa. This is sonship, meaning of sonship you learned. That from that day, you started calling your papa papa. Look at the type of, this is grieving my soul. It's grieving the soul of God. It's not church. It's not God. It's nothing that has to do with God. People's egocentrism. Apostle. Pastor. What stops you? You say, UNDBC calls me. Myself at UNDBC are 8 months. Probably a year. Maybe older than I am or something like that. Or maybe two, whatever. We are all in the same bracket of age. If tomorrow you call me, imagine, oh, how are you doing? That is war. How dare you? Huh? It's not even how dare you. First of all, come. Quick, my time is coming up. Masino, how are you?
Yo, Masino. How are you? Yo, Masino. How now?
When did that start?
But I senior you now. We're Africans, huh? You're supposed to respect me.
Do you know who I am? My name is Apostle, Prophet, Bishop Masino. When you address me henceforth, you call me either Apostle, Bishop. I don't even want Pastor, Bishop. Henceforth, if not, I excommunicate you from this church. Out of my sight. That's what we have made so-called men of God. We are men of men. When something else, when meekness is driving you, you don't need that. You don't need that. It doesn't edify you in any way. When Christ is the one, it is pushing people. You can easily tell if you are spiritual. The Bible says the spiritual man discerns all things. He knows all things. When you are spiritual, you can't fool me. A man who is always coming to me and pursuing things, preaching about things that don't resemble Christ doesn't impress me. I have seen through you. I know what's driving you. It's something starting with L and ends with R. I have seen somewhere in the middle of it. It's not God. It's Lucifer. I know what Holy Spirit looks like. I know what Jesus looks like. This is what these men were pursuing. They esteem the reproach. Why is it a reproach? Because the world called it a reproach. They look down at and they say, this is humility. Let it be. That's what I want. You know what it is to leave the palaces of Egypt? To go into the field with smelling goats and sheep and rams? You don't know what you're talking about. To reduce yourself. To become lowly in heart. He said, I am meek. I'm lowly in heart. See, you don't need to look far. What is called Christianity and men of God and women of God today, it's not Jesus type. It's another thing. We're not looking unto Jesus anymore. I have not even started to share what I wanted to share, but my time is gone. I know the Holy Spirit is speaking to somebody. The Holy Spirit is speaking to you. Stop. Don't think that Pastor Manson is just coming here to come and insult people. I have no interest in that. This is just the plain truth of God. Jesus went to people and said, you are a whitewashed sepulchre. Just imagine, sorry my dear brother, I call you now. Come, I beg. So how are you, sir? Come and say hello to me. How are you, sir? You are a Pharisee of which order? Mosaic order? You, all of you, are whitewashed sepulchre. You know what that means? If I tell you that, you don't go slap me. This guy, you know what? Jesus insulted some people. You know what it is? He said, look at all of you. Not one man. No. Imagine all of them gathered here. He said, look at all of you. You're coming around me. They are coming to listen to the word of God. Following him. Pretending though. And he saw through them. Yeah. Look at, you see? So these are the real audience following him. These are all of them. Pharisee, okay. Big man. You just look at big men. The order of the day. That's how Jesus preached. He looked at all of them. He told them, children, I tell you, these people you are looking at, they are all full of dead men's bones. You see them? With their lips, they are saying one thing. Their heart is saying another thing. Hypocrites, all of you. Hypocrites. We came to listen to your message. All of you, outwardly, you see, you deceive yourself. They started bringing out their issues. Thank you, sir. So I say, you tithe, give everything you have, but look at all of you. It's a lie. There's no love in your heart. There's no mercy in your heart. Then you are still questioning. We are too afraid to deal with truth because truth is sometimes bitter. He says, I tasted your word. It's like bitterness in my mouth. Truth that is too sweet is a truth you must be careful of. Jesus did not call us the sugar of the world. We are not the sugar of the earth. You are the salt of the earth. There's too much sugary going on. We need to be a bit salted. We need to be salted by some fire. We need to say it as it is sometimes. We need to say it as it is sometimes. I want to encourage some of you young people. I haven't listened to EX Ministries in a while. But a brother called me this last week and said, I've been listening to some guy that he reminded me of you. I used to listen to that guy, Craig Lewis of EX Lewis. And if you think that I'm blunt, you need to listen to him. You will know what is blunt. I'm not blunt. I pray that I reach that level actually. So those of you who are saying that I'm controversial, whatever, I haven't started yet. We need to deal, if not, this generation is passing away in torment. Sometimes we have to hold that whip and say, no, enough is enough. And this is the time. It's time for us to go back. We have to be witnesses of God. I want everybody to bow their heads to the Lord.
We trust that the Lord has been speaking to you through this message. Our prayer is that He will move mightily and is moving mightily in your life. We would like to hear from you, pray with you, and share your testimonies with you. You can reach us on 0809 Testify or call our church office on 01-453-2903. You can also send us an email on info@tbrchurch.org. Or better still, join us at one of our services on Sunday by 9 a.m. at 13A Ikorodu Road, Maryland, Lagos, Nigeria. God bless you.